George. And I made up a blank ahead of time for my mushroom. Come on out of there. And garaged it. And what the blank is composed of, you can sort of see where I'm going. That has that mushroomy shape blocked in. So what's under here is half of it is an opaque silver germanium. It's my silver germanium, which is comparable to caramel. And then I've coated it with Tag Double Mai Tai. And then down here I have white as the background and then a transparent yellow coating. And so the mushroom will be a two-tone. And the technique I'm using here, this is what the Mai Tai has some oxides in it that I find it's fun to kind of exploit by using a technique I call marbling. And that's where I turn my torch up here, get a fair amount of heat going, and I'm going to heat up this top, and I'm going to take the clear rod and just kind of whoosh around through it and ruck it up a bit, and it'll give us a whole range of different colors and swirls and stuff. So it's kind of it's a way to get a fair amount of pattern and some variation in the colors in a pretty easy technique. You do have to be a little bit careful about your swooshing around, because if you get the piece too hot, then you're going to be distorting your shape. So okay, there we go. So now I've done what's called unstriking here. This is a heat reactive color. The Mai Tai, all the Mai Tais are heat reactive. The very pale Mai Tai needs to be kiln struck. That's what that is. Okay, and now I'm waiting for a second here. I'm gonna, having warmed it up and unstruck it, I need to then actually flash it again after it's cooled. And you can still see it's glowing a bit. And I'll just get more of the swirling effect if I wait for a second before I flash it. So, and what the flashing does is it brings up like a little micro-thin film of silver luster onto the surface. That's what that bluing is and looks like. It also makes the color a little more opaque on the surface. So here we go. And by varying the heat of the color, the surface of the color, as I'm working through it, I'll also get a lot of different gradations in the color. And I'm using a fair amount of force to dig the color up and kind of ruck through it. There we go. Pull off there. So I'll just fuse that in and smooth it. There we go. Okay. And the angle I'm tilting it in the flame, I'm using gravity to help kind of make the top of the mushroom start to flop down and flatten out. Yeah. I'll go in with my graphite paddle here. And just start to form my shape. I don't hear, I'll turn towards you or something, I don't know. So I'm just mushing the top down, so it's going to look more like a mushroom. Pretty good. Ouch. And now I'm going to take out the, just smooth it out a little bit, fire polish it, and take out the chill marks. And then we'll wait a minute and let it cool and have a look at the pattern as it comes back up. That'll take a minute. It's pretty hot. And then what I'm going to do is, when I've kind of finished the base a little bit more, I'll make the snail in two parts. It'll be the you know, I start with the snail body so that I can size the shell to it. And the snail body doesn't have to be garaged. It can just kind of hang out. When I curl the shell up, it's going to be only a half seal, so that has to stay hot all the time. So, chilling it. So you can see some of the color coming up again as it cools. And as I work with this, and as it gets heated and reheated, it's going to progressively change. The colors will do some shifting back and forth. So yeah, you can see more patterns coming up. Just the way it's big, it takes a long time to cool. Probably flash it now. Let's see. So kids, don't do this at home. It's bad for your torch. but this is what I like to do when I'm flashing something like this, to have a look at what the pattern's doing. So this is kind of a neutral. This is just the outer fire without the inner fire on it. It's kind of a neutral atmosphere in the flame. So there we go, we got it. Well, I don't know if you guys can see that as it's cooling, there's a lot more of the swirling and some opaline. Can you guys see that? That's what the rucking up the Mai Tai does. Okay. So now I'm going to punt it onto the top here. And since this is an organic subject matter, you don't have to be real straight. It can be a little bit asymmetrical. And then what I like to do, since this is just a fantasy mushroom basically, is I like to put a little contrasting color rim around the bottom and put a few little dots on it. The one thing I didn't pull out. Okay, what did I do with it? Oh, there it is. I think I saw it. No, that's not it. Yeah, this will do. Okay. So this is some of my color that I've handmade. I restruck it in the kiln so I can see what the final result will be. And it's a dilute formula of copper and silver and germanium dioxide. And this is something I would mix in the torch. Building up a little foot there. Diffuse in. Just a couple little raised clusters around here. Sort of a little random pattern. I'll just half seal that in, so I'll leave them somewhat raised. It just makes it a little more interesting to look at. There we go. So that's well, even though it's raised, that's well sealed in there, and the mushroom itself has a lot of mass to it, so it should be okay. There shouldn't be too much of an issue with the raised dots. So now I'm gonna putty back on, and I'll put this in the garage, and I'll get onto the snail. to make sure it's a pretty good punty because that's a fair amount of weight. Staying out a little bit much because I'm rushing. Okay. All righty. Pulling off my excess clear here. Smooth that out. I don't like that. Was there a question or?
No, there's a laptop is getting questions on how to use that computer.
Oh, okay.
There is
a question. Oh, okay. Nobody's wondering what the hell I'm doing or anything. Garage that, and we'll start on the, yeah, oh, thank you, housekeeping, yeah, oh, okay, yeah, it's got kind of buried in my pocket here. What, you were asking about the Mai Tai, or?
That was just Mai Tai.
That was double Mai Tai, and it was backed, because double Mai Tai isn't as intense as mega Mai Tai, it was backed with something like caramel. So that gives you a neutral opaque background, doesn't really affect the color a lot, but it kind of keeps it from like getting cleared out, because if you're taking the clear and you really work it in there, you might get like a little clear window instead of seeing more color and design. Okay. So now I have my mushroom. I'm going to clean this end off a bit. So now I have some transparent yellow, if I can find it on my desk. Where did I put my big one? There's my big stringer. Okay. So I'm gonna make a nice little snail foot and head. This is a continuous coating, a continuous coiling of the yellow. Help that in. To pull this off with a punty and mash my snail body down. Actually, I can do it this way. No, no, I better do it this way. And the transparent yellow is a striking color, so that when it's you'll start to see some of the yellow, and then when it's through resting in the kiln, the yellow will have come back up completely. So it'll be a fairly slightly translucent but fairly opaque snail body. And this is, I'm just covering up some clear here. This is what I'm going to draw the neck and the head out of. So my snails have a certain amount of pride in themselves, and they kind of carry their heads up like that. And they're obviously escargot is what it is, you know. I'm going to change my axis again. Clean up that end. And then I'm going to take my masher and flatten the foot out. I used to make little tiny dragons sitting up and lizards. I put lizards on the mushrooms. Attaching the dragons to the mushrooms is kind of a tricky prospect. So I got a little schmutz from my masher there, but that's okay. We won't see that. So now what I need to do, I'm going to block in some of the shape, just going to pull the foot out a little bit, and then check it for size, because we don't want this snail to hang over both edges of the mushroom. It'd be too much. I think I could shrink it down a little bit. I think that's a little bit much. So back in you go. Oh, every time I stand up, I get this thing under me. So I'm just gonna shrink down this body a little bit, take a little bit away from it. It's easier to subtract something like this than to add to it, so. Oh, get off. Come on, you. Yeah. No. So I was just cleaning up my punty there because it was boily. And you cannot get a good connection if you're joining two pieces of glass if there's a lot of little air bubbles in your interface. And there's nothing worse than having your snail drop off of your punty just as you're finishing it. Well, there are things that are worse than that. But it's nice to avoid. So now I'm taking this little glob here that I've made. I'm going to draw the neck out just by putting some heat into it and kind of fiddling with it. There. And now I'll make his little face. Just looking for a certain proportion.
Is that more reality putting on it?
Yeah. Yeah, just to build out the face a little bit. The head, you know. Because I like to give them a little pointy nose and then give them a mustache. Okay. Checking to see that he's looking straight. And now I'm going to give him his little antenna. Or eye stalks. They're not really antenna, are they? They're eye stalks. Fusing in that connection pretty well. There's no seam. So hopefully he won't lose any of his antenna or his eye stalks. it out a little bit. And I have a little bit of black, if I can find it. Oh, it's on the end of this. Oh, wait. I'm not gonna use that black. I do actually have a little bit more black. I just have to locate it. And like I said, anything that's this uniform in its thicknesses and uncomplicated, it's really almost a single piece here. You don't have to be freaking out about keeping it hot all the time. Oh, come on, I know I have it here. Where is it? What have I done with it? Ah, it's right in front of me. Okay. So this is a little bit of heat-sensitive black. I developed this formula a few years ago, actually quite a few years ago, and we call it Sable. It's nickel oxide and germanium dioxide, and it makes a very nice stable black, but it has to be reheated in the kiln to bring it all out. Oh, I'm not going to give you a black mustache. I'm going to give you a yellow mustache. And there we go. Clean that up. Guide that back a little bit. This is just futzing. You don't have to futz as much as I do. Yeah, that's very jaunty. He's kind of the Hercule Poirot of snails. Okay, so there we go. Let's see how he compares size-wise on this structure. Oh, that's good. Okay, I like that. That's fun. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to make the snail shell, and then I'm going to attach the body and seal that onto the mushroom, and then we will put the shell on. You can do it either way. I find that fusing the body on is maybe a little more secure before you put the shell on the body. I don't have to do that. I'm going to leave him here so I can see him. So for the body, what I'm going to do is take some of my hand-mixed silver and germanium, which is like an amber purple or a double amber purple, and pull out that one. So make a little blank and put a few little hobnails for decoration on it. Okay. Okay. And so just to try to figure out how big this shell is, you're just sort of eyeballing it, and you hope you're kind of within tolerances. Because I'm going to pull this out and then coil it, I think that'll be okay. And because this is a fairly intense piece of amber purple, as I am fusing the coils in, I'm burning off a haze. We've been discussing this in the class for a couple days. If you don't remove the haze as you are fusing the coils in, that is what makes like commercial silver strikes and amber purple colors get a yucky kind of opaque grayish tannish coating. So using an oxidizing atmosphere in your flame, you can strip that all off, and then you just have the nice color. I just touched my microphone. I hope I didn't bang it. So I'm letting that set up here. We'll have a look at the color. As it cools. So this has cooled down enough in the air now. I can just flash this again a little bit. It's just the way I did with the top of the mushroom. And that will bring up another little microfilm of the silver oxide. Right now, this is what one would call unstruck. This is the, I don't want to get into covalence bonds, so I won't. That's too complicated. I'm not Jesse. So I'm just going to flash this, and that will bring up that blue coating, that blue appearance. And that will deposit like just a little layer of silver on the surface, and then I can put my dots on it, and it'll put a little shine behind them. Okay, so there, I've got my, just a little design to make the shell interesting. Fuse that in. And And again, I'm holding it at an angle in the flame so that the gather will start to elongate, because I'm going to punty on and pull it, but I can use gravity to start my shaping process. Yeah, that'll be fine. Can I get that off? Nope. No. So I'm just putting some heat into it and starting to pull gently to elongate the gather, and then I can just sort of roll it up on itself. I'm trying to keep it fairly uniform. So this is just one of those things where you have to kind of finesse it as you're going. This is a particular design that John Burton, who was my mentor and developed a lot of the techniques I use for flame working, made up to make snails. These are a bit similar to what his snails look like. If you have his book, you can look in there and see his little snails in the illustrations. So I'm just coiling that back on itself. And it is kind of a semi-cold seal, and that's why it's a little bit on the touchy side about getting too chilled. You know, I don't remember the exact. I think he called it glass.
Yeah.
And was that his title? I think we have like a little bibliographic list of books. So yeah. Yeah, I'm sure you can go into any used bookstore and find a copy. Heating that connection. Okay, that's pretty good. All right, so I've got it coiled up. I'm gonna mash it up a little bit. Yeah, I'll be fine. And I'm just doing a little shaping. So that's the sort of roll-up effect you get. And that's John Burton's snail shell. And then what I like to do is get myself in all sorts of trouble here. I like to put a little rim around the shell, just because it's pretty. It's sort of like a little decorative bead. So I will take, first, let's flatten that out a bit. So that'll be my attachment point for the shell. Fuse that in. And then kind of flatten it. Let's see how that's looking. That's pretty good. That will look pretty good there. Okay. And then I'm gonna just pull that shell out, the tail bit out a little bit. You all thought, oh, a snail, that'll be quick. That'll be easy. I'm just flashing that half seal there just to make sure that everything is happy. And I'm going to put sort of like a little attachment bar here, just a little extra bit of glass, so that when the time comes, it'll be kind of easy to heat up the body and then kind of mash it all together. A little bit. Okay. Good. Alrighty, there we go. So we'll put this into the kiln to keep it toasty. And then we'll attach the snail and then the shell. I really like that polar bear. That is a really cute polar bear. Yeah. Did it just fall down? Yes, it did. Thank you. Thank you for observing that. Here, I better, before I get carried away with anything else, I better. Actually, no, I'm going to let that warm up a bit. So I'll take this out and then I'll repunty it after it's settled a little bit in the kiln. So that's where we're at so far in terms of, like, I don't know if you guys can see the color well here or not. Yeah, so it's really deepening up a lot. And it'll continue to change as I'm reheating it and shifting it back and forth. So now I'm going to kind of look at the pattern a little bit. Ah, don't do that, Bella. Look at the pattern a little bit and just decide what face I like before I apply my snail. What do you mean by haze?
Want the Mai Tai, you don't get another haze on it.
No. It'll just, the colors will kind of change back and forth. I burned the haze off before I did the marbling. So, maybe I'm not getting the term right with you. What haze are we thinking about?
Yeah, the haze.
No, it'll just, yeah, this is like the under, after you've burnt off the metallic haze. This is kind of the undercoating. And it'll alter. It's got the clear underneath. I can unstrike it and restrike it, and it will alter its appearance. Schmutz on everything. Yeah. Well, I think that's going to get covered up, so I'm not going to worry about it. So I'm just making sure that's well fused. Just working it in a bit. But I don't want to smoosh it down and have it like really be sealed to the piece, because then it won't look like he's just climbing up the shell or the mushroom to have a look at things. Okay, I like that better. Okay. Alrighty, so in he goes for a minute while I fish around here. I always hate reaching around my torch when it's on. I always think I'm going to set my hair on fire. There we go. Let's see, what have we got? No, I think this will be okay. Ouch. Come on back. Ow. There. Okay. Gotcha. Okay. So I think that will be fine. Hunty back on here. And I think I'll just flash it a little bit while we're letting the mushroom heat up a tiny bit more. Going to go for it. Now I have to stop and think for a second here. I don't have my usual stuff here. How am I going to hold that when I take it off the punty? Do we have like any Kevlar gloves or anything? I didn't think of that because I have stuff at home that I use, but well, what do we have? I think I would maybe rather have a glove. I'm not sure. It won't be red hot. What are they? Okay. I'm trying to think now. Maybe I can just do it with my pliers. Well, why don't you leave the gloves out? Yeah, in case I come a cropper here.
I can pretty much grab something on my side of the belt and those.
Yeah, okay. There we go. There's my little guy. Let's make sure there's nothing dusty on him. Here, and we'll just get him together. Heating up my two parts here, trying to eyeball it. Oops, don't do that. Okay. There we go. Okay, good. Oh, good, I like that. That was a good seal. I got that surface of his body pretty molten when I made that connection. Again, it's not going to be like a super good seal, but just annealing it in the kiln should take care of any stress. Take care of that little distortion I put in there. You what? Oh, thank you. Okay. Well, maybe we could let's put one down there in case my pliers slip so that it'd have a softer landing. Maybe these. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So what I'm doing right now is I'm just unstriking the shell, the amber purple in the shell. And that's just kind of an aesthetic thing. Okay. Well, you look very pleased with yourself, Mr. Snail. Okay. So here we go. I'm just trying to warm up, put a little more heat into the core before I start to spot heat. And remove the punty. And because it's so big, it's taking a little bit of time to take on a glow here, as you can see. And also I'm using a smaller diameter flame because I'm trying not to lose any of my detail. There we go. Okay, I think that's pretty good. Alrighty. Little snail, be good to me. I didn't need to. There we go. So I'm just wiping off my punty. Oh, that was exciting. off my punty here. Come on, baby. Swap over here. Pull off a little more. Okay, that should do it. So then I'll set him up. He should set up pretty good just with his weight. Don't let go. There we go. Yeah. There we go. He's good. He's got a little bit of lean to one side. Yeah. It's only a demo. He can lean any way he wants to. Okay. So in he goes. Ah, don't let go. Oops, he fell over, but he's good. Let me poke him upright again. Thank you.